Hey everybody, welcome to Evangelistic Center Church Online, and thank you for joining us. We believe Church Online is more than just a streaming service. It's a full worship community that you can be a part of wherever you are. From our weekly services that help you know more about God, to our life groups that help you find your freedom, our online growth track classes that help you discover purpose, and our EC Facebook group that will help you connect with other believers in your area to organize and make a difference in your community. If you're viewing us for the first time, let us know that you're there. You can comment in the live group chat or text the word ENU to the number below on the screen to receive a special gift from us, just so we can show our appreciation for you joining us in this online worship experience. Or you can also text the word ECARD to that same number if you want to learn more information about Evangelistic Center and tell us how we can help you and how we can connect with you. Our worship services will get started in just a few moments, but we wanted to make sure that we took the time out to tell you about the many different ways that you can get connected here at EC and the resources that we have put in place to help you grow. First is our Facebook group, EC Family. When you join this group, you'll be connected with an encouraging community of believers from all over the world. You'll also find encouraging weekly devotions from our EC staff, Bible plans, live worship from our amazing worship leaders, and important information about how you can get connected here at EC. Join our Facebook group today. Loving God and loving people is essential for your life, but we want you to know that you can't do it without a community of people surrounding you. We created life groups as a safe place where we can grow with God and connect with others. Our life groups are held each quarter for 7 weeks. Each group is unique. Each group is special. We have life groups for men, women, young adults, teens, girls, widows, and even married couples. You can join one of our life groups by visiting our website, select the word life groups, and then click the sign up button for the group that you wish to join. You can also join a group by texting the word groups to the number below on the screen or email us directly for more information. Our hope is that you choose a group, sign up, and join us whenever you can. You want to join EC in serving your community, your city, or perhaps the world? We believe the first step is attending Growth Track. Growth Track is a series of courses designed to help you learn about the values of our church, understand foundational truths about God, discover your gifts, and get connected to a serve team. You can sign up to attend Growth Track courses by texting the word growth to the number below on the screen, or you can also email us directly for more information. We want you to know that you can join in the worship experience right where you are. You can join in by raising your hands, you can join in by singing along with the worship team, or you can even join along by giving. If you would like to give today, please text the letters EC along with the amount that you'd like to give to the number 45777. You can also go to our website and select give or mail your gift in to us. Are you ready for church online? Here's what you can do. You can grab a cup of coffee if you see fit to do so, find a comfy spot, gather around your device, because we're just a few minutes away from the worship experience of a lifetime.
Glorified, be glorified, be glorified, be glorified. Where you would be. I know right now in this time, we can say that right now that we're free in Jesus. Whom the Son sets free is truly free indeed. Our minds are free. Our souls are free. Our spirits are free, because it's all because of Jesus, who gave his life on Calvary. And we can let him know right now, yes, you loose my shackles and you set me free. You've been mighty good. You've been mighty good. Yes. You loose my shackles and you set me free. You've been mighty good. Yes, God. You've been mighty good. Come on, come on. You loose my shackles and you loose my every chain and you broke every fetter. Oh, come on and bring it in harmony. Help me sing. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, Lord. Come on, tell him. He's been mighty good. Can't nobody do me like you, Lord. Yeah. Hey. Oh, yes. Lord, you've been mighty good to me. Lord, you've been mighty good to me. Come on, sing. Loose my shackles and you set me free. Yeah, Lord. Thank you for freeing me, Jesus. Thank you for setting me free, Lord. I don't have to be bound no more. Hey, oh. begin to think back and wonder why, how come God has been good. Oh, you've been mighty good. Oh, you've been mighty good. When I think about what I used to do, when I think about what I used to say, but your grace and your mercy, it kept me. And your grace and your mercy protected me.
Another way. Oh, no, no, no.
about you, but I feel that thing. He's better than good to me. He's better than good to me. Somebody just ought to start speaking that or walking around your living room saying, child, he's been better than good to me. You may think that you're stuck at home, but you better encourage yourself. Say, I'm safe at home. I'm safe. I'm in his safety. I'm in his safety. His arms are around me and they're protecting me because, oh, trust me, it could have went another way. But his amazing grace, hallelujah, his amazing grace, and his mercies are new every morning, Vashe. Hallelujah. We bless your wonderful and holy name, Jesus, because you are a present God in the time of need. A present God right now, Lord. When we need you, when we call upon you, and we need you to help us, God, you are a present God. And we thank you for hearing our cry. We thank you for inclining your ear unto us, oh God, and we thank you on this morning. Oh, we bless your name, Jesus. We bless your wonderful name, Jesus. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yay! I don't know about you, but I'm so happy that I know God will see me through. It could have went another way. It could have been me. Shackles and you set me free. You've been mighty good. You've been mighty good. Hallelujah.
A warm welcome to all of you, our EC family, our EC partners, and our friends. Once again, we're gathered via technology, your phone, your computer, through the internet. Though we are the church scattered, we are still the church connected from house to house and from heart to heart. I'm grateful today for our media and our marketing team, our tech staff, who have made it possible every week for us to come together through technology for the Lord's purposes. And I want to thank the Father because he trumps the devil every time, and we're building his kingdom now through technology. With our online campus church, I want to celebrate that 9 souls have come and given their life to the Lord in our online campus. What an exciting news that is to receive, and what an exciting hour this is at EC. If you're without a church home in this hour, I want to welcome you to join us in our online church. We'd be delighted to shepherd you wherever you are in the world, wherever you are in the country. And a great shout out to our EC family in Japan, our EC family in Korea, and our EC family in Germany. So we thank God for you across the waters, across the seas. And if you want to be able to have someone shepherd you and walk you through, we'd like to do that. And we'd like to do life with you and help you in your life. So go to our webpage and see what we're getting ready to roll out and what's already rolling out. We're excited about our EC staff and our team who are really working hard to make sure that we're connected and you're connected with us. It's an exciting time here at EC and an exciting time to be a part of the EC ministry. I want to thank you because you are an amazing group of people, an amazing congregation, amazing community of believers. Thank you for your support, your tithe and offering. It is just overwhelming us in the office as tithes and offerings are coming through for those that don't do online giving. And I want to personally thank you for your personal contributions to me as a leader and your cash apps and things of that nature and your texting and saying, Bishop, thank you. Keep doing what you're doing. This is just something to say we're blessed and we want to show our appreciation to you for the time that you're putting in to keep us connected. Your generosity is enabling us to do ministry at this level. because it takes resources to keep the technology rolling out to you and keep these services coming, and you're helping us do that. And my prayer is that you'll have a harvest for every seed you sowed. And my saying is, call your harvest in. So as you call that harvest in this season, I want to take you to a passage of scripture. You know, in my times of walking the past few weeks and just communing with the Lord in those inner conversations that He and I have, and those are your most powerful times of communion with the Lord when you're having those inner conversations. And He ministers to me, and I minister back to Him, and we share and we laugh, and I want you to know you can have fun in your relationship with the Lord. But this passage of scripture, I believe prophetically, He was speaking to me concerning you, concerning His people, and concerning where the times are. And He directed my attention to 1 Kings chapter 17. I want to read that verses 7 through 24. Might sound like a lot of reading, but listen to the story here because it is the symbolism of where we are. It is a picture of the last day church and what's happening even in this pandemic. And it reads, sometime later, the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to him, go at once to Zarephath in the region of Sidon and stay there. I have directed a widow there to supply you with food. So he went to Zarephath. When he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and asked, would you bring me a little water in a jar so I may have a drink? As she was going to get it, he called, and bring me please a piece of bread. As surely as the Lord your God lives, she replied, I don't have any bread, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little olive oil in a jug. I'm gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself, my son, that we may eat it and die. Elijah said to her, don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said. But first, make a small loaf of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me, and then make something for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. The jar of flour will not be used up, and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the land. She went away and did as Elijah had told her. So there was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and her family. For the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah. Sometime later, the son of the woman who owned the house became ill. He grew worse and worse and finally stopped breathing. She said to Elijah, what do you have against me, man of God? Did you come to remind me of my sin and kill my son? Give me your son, Elijah replied. He took him from her arms, carried him up to the upper room where he was staying, and laid him on the bed. Then he cried out to the Lord, Lord my God, have you brought tragedy even upon this widow I'm staying with by causing her son to die? Then he stretched himself out on the boy three times and cried out to the Lord, Lord my God, let this boy's life return to him. The Lord heard Elijah's cry, and the boy's life returned to him, and he lived. Elijah picked up the child, carried him down the room into the house. He gave him to his mother and said, look, your son is alive. Then the woman said to Elijah, now I know that you are a man of God and that the word of the Lord from your mouth is the truth. Thank God for the reading of His word. Your takeaway today, and I want you to embed this in your spirit, write it down, the Elijah Church. What do you do when the brook dries up? That's your takeaway. What do you do when the brook dries up? I want to give a tagline to that because I believe we're in the season of the Elijah Church. I want to give a passage of scripture for emphasis to add to that text, 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 20. And it says, and they rose early in the morning and went forth into the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, O Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, so shall ye be established. Believe his prophets, so shall you prosper. That's for emphasis in a time such as this, that you will believe in the Lord your God, so you will be established, and believe the word of the Lord that comes from the man and the women of God, so shall you prosper. Let's look at the backdrop of this text today. Ahab was one wicked king. He was king at this time. He was so evil, in fact, that the scripture says that Ahab did more to provoke the Lord, the God of Israel, to anger than did all the kings of Israel before him. In 1 Kings chapter 16, verse 33. Now that's a pretty wicked king, that you're doing more than all the kings in Israel to provoke the Lord. History has him recorded as he was one dark king. There's nothing more devastating for a nation, for a country, for an organization, whether it is a religious organization, a non-religious organization, when power falls into the wrong hands. What we see in the text is the life of Elijah is a picture of the last day church. And that's why I said we're in the season now of the Elijah church. Every nation has an immigration system and a travel policy. To go to most countries, you need a passport. When traveling, if you get into difficulty, the passport gives you certain rights at your country's embassy. Now, at the embassy will be an ambassador who represents his country. Now, the ambassador has diplomatic privileges. The embassy is deemed to be a part of the country's soil, even though it is in a foreign place. It is the same as if it was in that country's soil. It is the same in God's kingdom. We are his ambassadors and we are his representatives, meaning we should reveal the customs and culture of God. Elijah had visited the court of King Ahab, this wicked king. He had spoken on behalf of God, and he made his trip from obscurity into Ahab's court and declared war. And sometimes, because our brook dries up, because like Elijah, his brook dried up because he prayed that there was no rain. And eventually Elijah's source of water dried up. Sometimes when we are declaring war or we're in spiritual warfare, sometimes we are recipients of the impact of what we're praying for. But even God is God in the midst of those situations. Every believer will go through this desert school of learning, just like Elijah. Again, he is the picture of the last day church. Now, Elijah had gone through the desert school of learning. In our world, along with some of the florid and peaceful gardens, there are now many deserts. And deserts are significant in the life of believers, because right now it's almost like we're in a desert school of learning. We're living through something we have never experienced before in our lifetime. We're seeing the world and a different picture of how the world looks in this desert school of learning. Brooks are drying up all over the place. Unemployment rate at a enormous rate. We're seeing the shutdown of businesses. Some will recover and some will not. Never in my lifetime have I seen houses of worship having to close down in our lifetime. And yet we see that some will recover and some are just wondering, will I be able to recover in a time like this? So we're in this desert school of learning where brooks are drying up all over the place. Deserts are places ill-suited for humans. It's not a place that we really want to live. Unprepared to deal with the extreme geographical features, they lack water, the vegetation is sparse, creatures that dwell there are often predatory, and many are poisonous. So our deserts can be literal or they can be metaphorical. But in the Bible, we learn that they can be the very places that God finally finds us and calls us back to life in him. That's why I say you're going to have a desert school of learning. When your brook dries up, what do? You listen to the voice of God. You follow his steps, and he's already mapped them out. Can I say that again? Listen to the voice of God, follow his steps, and know that he's already mapped them out. It said, and it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, it wasn't his idea. It was God mapping out his steps. And he said, arise, get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zion, and dwell there, behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. In other words, get up. I've already mapped it out. I've already gone before you. And sometimes it's our unknowns that bring the uncertainty, because God doesn't give us a lot of details, but he does give us indicators and gives us enough to trust him and to know that if we trust him, he has the situation. So why not a woman of wealth, I ask? Why not a two-person household with great resources? Why does he send him, think about it, to a widow? No husband, no covering, a widow with a young son. And widowhood in the Bible often represented death. It often represented the presence of lack, no covering. And perhaps there is someone listening to me right now that said, you know, that's exactly where I'm at right now. I'm in a desert. I'm at a place where I feel God calling me back to life in him. And that's the kind of school Elijah came through, the desert school of learning. He had communion. He had in that desert a rock, a spiritual rock to drink from. He feasted on manna, and he had his flesh cut away. It's amazing what God does in our desert, isn't it? It's amazing how he deals with us at a level of intensity, and now it's time to move on to what's next. Perhaps your spirit is saying to you, Father, what's next for me? I'm in this desert. What's the next move? Where am I going from here? If you're in a desert school of learning, God has already mapped out your footsteps. Remember, the psalmist reminds us, and I love Psalms 31, because this ministers to me many times, and I have questions when the uncertainty is there, and the what-ifs will try to come. And he says in Psalms 31 and 1, my times are in your hands. In other words, he's saying the times when the desert heat is overwhelming, I'm walking with you. The times when the desert heat is overwhelming, sometimes we're almost to faint, then he picks us up and he carries us to the next place of provision. So my friend, when your brook dries up, God has another place to feed you. When the brook dries up, God has another place to use you. There are many lessons to be learned beside the brook. Timing is always an issue though with us. When to move, where to move. Ecclesiastes chapter 31, verse 11, 1 through 11 says to everything there is a season. And one thing I've learned, God is the only one that can create seasons. And we know we have four seasons, don't we? We have winter, we have spring, we have summer, and we have fall. But then there's a fifth season that God creates, especially for his people. It's called a due season. I've seen you go through, and now it's your due season. It's your reward. It's your season of trusting me and the benefits of those that diligently seek me. So, but he gives us time, and he gives us time as a gift. And you know, when God gives us time, it's a period that's allotted to us for a specific purpose. You know, in the mornings when I get up, the first thing I say is, thank you, God, for being on the wake-up list today. Thank you, God, as my mom would say, I live to be 95. I thank God I'm on top of the green space today. I said, thank you, this day that you've given me, this day is for purpose. There's something I am to fulfill. There's something I am to do for you today, to worship you, give you the glory, touch somebody's life, and allow somebody to touch my life. So time is a period allotted for a specific purpose. And you know, he places us, and he says that I'm going to place you in time, but I'm going to put eternity in your hearts. So you know, you're still here because God has a purpose for you. That thing could have taken you out. That thing could have wiped you out years ago, but God has a purpose. Even in this pandemic, if you're still here, God has a purpose for you. He puts eternity in our hearts, but he is the only one that knows the beginning to the end. And yet in the natural world, we function in time periods, in hours such as this. It is one thing to know God's word, yet it is another to walk in it. I tell you what he expects, though. God expects you and I to eat at his command and to move at his command. We must obey all the commands, whether we like them or not. It's so critical, particularly in this hour, in this crisis, that you as a believer stay grounded. Again, I say that. Take faith over fear and stay grounded in your emotions, in your psyche. Stay grounded in your spirit. Stay grounded. We must obey all of his commands, whether we like them or not, whether you understand it or not. If God is saying, get up, do this, get up here, go where, I need you to do this, I need you to do that. Be spontaneous to the command of the Lord, because it's always a blessing on the other side of your obedience. You know, it's one thing to say we believe, and it's another thing to act in faith. We as followers of Christ cannot behave And we cannot act like God's a liar. You know, one day I was walking and the Lord and I were talking and he said, I don't need my children to act like I'm a liar. I need them to act as if they trust the promise and everything I've said to them. We cannot act like God is incapable of standing by what he promised. And the same God that did it then, he can do it again. You know, we have t-shirts and we have the hoodies in our store down here in the same, in our campus here, in our building, and the hoodies say, won't he do it? You know, and sometimes we have to remind ourselves that he will do it every time. We cannot act like he's incapable of fulfilling his word. Jesus even said in his word in Matthew chapter 24, verse 35, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. And then he said in Luke 1 and 37, for no word from God will ever fail. The question at hand is, though, what do you do when the brook dries up? When your brook dries up, God may send you right in the middle of a drought. He could be planning a greater miracle at the next place. When we look at Zarephath, Elijah's faith was to be tested. Zarephath means crucible. It means a place of testing. Elijah was led from the frying pan into the fire. Have you ever felt like that? I have, that God was taking me from the frying pan into the fire. Zarephath was outside of the promised land. It's in the land that we call Lebanon now. Elijah, he enjoyed the abundance of Cherith, but now God was about to teach him something. Keep in mind that Cherith means a cutting. It means a separation. God cuts the prophet away from his comfort, even in his hiding. You know, he's used to all of these provisions now, and then God leads him right into a drought, tells him to get up, go to Zarephath, where he's learning to live now from hand to mouth. And that's not something all of us like. You know, we like being on the giving end, don't we? We like being able to bless this one and bless that other one over there. But what happens when our brook dries up? What happens? Do we have a problem receiving when God is trying to teach us something? Because he's trying to teach you something. And on the other hand, the person that God is having give to you, they're learning something also. So all to experience a greater miracle. He is driven into a drought to live from hand to mouth, to experience a greater miracle. Who knows? God has positioned you for where you are right now for you to experience a greater miracle, for him to show up in such an incredible and an awesome way in your life. The natural was going to be transformed for Elijah and for this woman by the supernatural. Zarephath was a place where the impossible became possible. Fed by ravens, by the brook, fed by crews of oil and a barrel of meal. Every child of God will have a Zarephath experience. A place where your faith gets tested. And I believe that's where we are right now. I believe that's where the church is. I believe we're in a season now of the Elijah church, the place of being tested. I know we're in a pandemic, and as a watchman on the wall, I know that we're in a prophetic hour, a prophetic season. I want to call it the Elijah church season, the season to believe the prophet who represents the word of God. If you can just grab hold of what I'm teaching right now, the word that I'm giving you today, the messenger who speaks, the word of the Lord, so shall you prosper. Notice the statement found in both places. The word of the Lord came to him. The word of the Lord. What do you have in the place of prosperity? What do you have in the place of poverty? You have his word. You have his promises. And then I thought about what the psalmist said in Psalms 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I see in the spirit an Elijah season upon us. Testimonies have been rolling in. And someone texted me the other day, I got a 20% raise. Who gets that in a pandemic? Somebody else texted me, said I got a $20,000 raise. Who gets that in a pandemic? Testimony after testimony. And as I see, as Elijah helped this hopeless widow, she provided for him. I know firsthand that there are times that the Holy Spirit will whisper, even to me, and says, keep doing what you're doing. He'll say, you continue feeding my sheep and I will provide for you. He is faithful, I'm telling you. I sit here with laughter in my heart to tell you God is faithful to his word. I want to reiterate the lyrics to the song by Donnie McClurkin, No God Like Jehovah. And I encourage you to play that this week in your meditation. Play it in your home. If you're in a desert place right now, he said, these are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And that's what I'm doing today. I'm declaring the word of the Lord to you. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. I believe God is restoring righteousness among us. These are the days of great trials, of famine and darkness of sword. Still, we are in the void. We are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. I believe all of this is a precursor for a new world that's on the rise, for a remnant of a new church that's on the rise to prepare the way of the Lord. Say, behold, he comes riding on clouds, shining like the sun, and the trumpets call. Lift your voice, year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's heel, salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are all white in your world. And we are the laborers that are in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. I believe that the harvest is ripe, right about now. I believe that the messages today in this hour are the messages and the voice of revelation. I believe it is a prophetic voice preparing the world, preparing the church, getting the bride ready to prepare the way for the coming of the Lord. When it is evident in a nation, though nothing happens without coming through the counsel of his will, God will use as an opportunity, even when the power of leadership seems to have fallen into the wrong hands. Ahab was a wicked king, more wicked than any of the kings in Israel. But God will use the enemy to get his children, to get his church, the ones he loves so dearly, to get you, to get them, to get us back on track. When God loves you, he has a way of coming to get you and get you back on track. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 5 says, you must remember that the Lord your God teaches and corrects you as a father teaches and corrects his son. I'm a strong believer that God will use the desert. He'll use it. He'll use adversity. He'll use hardship. He'll use crisis. He'll use heartbreak, disappointment, shutdowns, famines, pestilences, even the stay-at-home order, and the list goes on, to get the world's attention. He'll use that to cause us to prioritize and to step back and reevaluate our relationship, to reevaluate what's important and what's not so important. He'll use that to get his children, get his church back on track, and say still to mankind, the earth is still mine and the fullness thereof and everything in it, Psalms 24. In other words, I've got the whole world in my hands. If you take a look at the scene, with Elijah, you will see that God sent the prophet Elijah to confront King Ahab. Let's walk through these scenes real briefly. And to declare no rain would fall on the land until the Lord gave the word. Judgment had come for 1,000 wicked deeds. Then God instructed the prophet to get away from there and hide by the brook Cherith. He, God, takes care of him via ravens that would feeding bread, bringing meat, morning and evening, and Elijah could drink the water from the brook. Elijah the prophet obeyed God, left the outcomes up to God. He didn't try to troubleshoot for God. He didn't try to figure it out and help God out. He simply obeyed, and God mapped out the steps. Various reactions when God moves you from Cherith. Sometimes you fight it because you're afraid of the future. You can fear it because you don't trust God to provide in the future. You can faint and not move forward. You can flounder because you won't listen to the direction of the word of the Lord, or you can follow the word of the Lord because you know God will provide. And where God provides, God guides. Just know that where God guides, he provides. However, sometime later, the brook dried up. Look at this. Because the drought in the land, 1 Kings 17:7, the brook dried up. God tells us in Isaiah 55:8-9, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than yours and my thoughts than your thoughts. Don't even try to figure out God. Just trust him. Don't even try to figure out what's next. Just trust him. God sent him to the brook. Elijah was living in obedience. The miracle of the ravens was happening. Why was it a miracle of ravens? Now that's an amazing thing there, because please understand why a raven. Ravens are considered extremely intelligent birds, but they're scavengers. They eat berries, they eat fruit, insects, flesh, and even the flesh of dead animals. Ravens feed greedily. They eat greedily, prey on or hunt and obtain by a seas of violence, very aggressive. The color of a raven is jet black, symbolizing darkness. Even in some cases, a raven represents Satan and unrest, a symbol of ill fortune. And God uses a raven. The thing that should have devoured what they were bringing to Elijah, the thing that should have ate it greedily and consumed it, God tells the prophet that unclean birds are going to be bringing him food. Now, I wonder what Elijah thought about that when God tells him ravens are going to feed you. I wonder if he said ravens, scavengers, Those birds are going to be feeding me, but I'm telling you, God will use whoever he wants, whatever he wants, to get a message over to his people. And thus they came to the prophet's aid. Listen to this. The interesting thing, God did not allow Elijah to hoard up anything. He didn't allow him to stack it up and to gain to gather it for the next day and the next day. He's in a school of learning. The ravens came daily, and it reminds me of the Lord's Prayer, give us this day our daily bread. Listen, God sends Elijah to the brook, and the brook dries up. Truth number one, obeying God doesn't mean that the brook won't dry up. Did it mean Elijah had sinned? Did it mean that Elijah was out of God's will? Did it mean that God was displeased with him? No, and no again. It meant that God had another place for him. It meant that God had another plan. It even meant that Elijah was to put his trust in God and not the brook. So important, because the brook could represent the provision for the moment. It could represent your job. It could represent the bank account. It could represent your business. It could represent your gifts and your talents. Look at scene two. What to expect at the next place. God has already provided for the next place. May I tell you, God's already got you covered tomorrow. God's already got you covered next week. He's already got you covered next month, the month after that, the month after that, 2021, 2022, and you can go on. God instructed the prophet to walk 100 miles north to a city named Zarephath. There he would find a widow who would provide for him. Elijah is probably looking forward to right about now, good home cooking. God's thoughts, again, are not our thoughts, and his ways are not our ways. If you look at this scene, I guarantee you, had that scenario played out in today's society, Elijah would have been hung out to dry. The world would say, you know what? That preacher should be ashamed of himself, asking that poor widow for her last meal and her all. Can't he see? She only has enough to feed her son. The nerve of him asking for her last. On top of that, he's asking her to bake his cake first. If she does that, what's going to be left for her and her poor son? That's how the carnal mind would think and perceive it. But what the carnal mind never sees is that little is much when you place it in the Lord's hands. If he can do two fish and five loaves of bread and feed 5,000 and have some left over, I'm convinced God has a track record. First of all, this is not just any man off the street asking her to do this. When God sets a man of God in the midst of his people, he's not just some Johnny come lately off the street. This is a prophet sent to the people. He represents God's blessing of provision. He represents the promise of God to his children. He represents the word of God. Verse 8 says, and the word of the Lord came to him saying, the man of God is sent to this woman's house for God to bestow a blessing upon her life and her house, and for him to be blessed in return. The man of God prays, blesses her, and she in return blesses him. Look at what it said. For this is what the Lord God of Israel says, the jar of flour will not be used up, and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the land. Listen at this. It is called feeding that that feeds you. It's called blessing that that blesses you. And Elijah obeyed God. So again, what do? When the brook dries up. We're in an hour now where the believer has to obey God and leave the outcomes to him. So Elijah walked the long road, found the widow near the gate of the city. She was gathering sticks. She was down to her last bit of flour and oil. Here's the mindset of the widow. The decision has been made. I'm gonna gather sticks, make a fire, bake a little loaf of bread for herself and for her son. Then we're gonna eat it and we're gonna die. Point I wanna make on that, you gotta watch your mindset. You gotta watch your mindset in a crisis. You gotta watch your mindset in your trial. You gotta watch your mindset even in this pandemic. Once your mindset changes, everything on the outside will change along with it. In this hour, I want you to eliminate the mindset of eat it and die. The serious mindset of this widow, eat it and die. 1 Kings 17 and 12. Hear me, every widow, hear me, every believer, hear me. According to the famine, according to what she had in the house, she is thinking, looking at the facts, that the end has come for the widow and her son. Once you assess your facts, then let your faith kick in for supernatural intervention and a miracle. Expect a miracle. Expect the impossible. Feel the intangible. See the invisible. Because God has other plans for the widow. God has other plans for the prophet. And he has, outside of the facts of what it looks like right now, he has other plans for you. He's got great plans for you. It could be where you are is a setup for your next miracle. I believe God had a menu on his mind. And when I was crafting this out, I kind of got tickled because I believe he has a sense of humor. I believe that God was thinking, okay, I got to bless this meal barrel because the first day they'll have breakfast, they'll have pancakes, they'll have biscuits for lunch, and they'll have dumplings for dinner. You know, and I believe God was saying, you know what? It might be good the second day to have fried corn cakes, have bread and sopping all with it. You know how your grandparents used to do it, my dad and them, have the hot bread, take it out of the oven, just sop it in the syrup. And I believe God was saying, you know, tortillas sound real good for dinner. And I believe for dessert, let's just make some bread pudding. I mean, just stuff started rolling out. Every time she went to the meal barrel, went to the jar of oil, there was always some. Man, isn't it amazing about God how awesome he is? Even when you think, I mean, I know that from experience. Even when you think you're down to the last, all of a sudden, I'm telling you, all through this pandemic, God has blown me away. You know, somebody called me and said, I got surplus and I was getting ready to do something with it. And the Lord told me, he said, no, you bless the man of God, bless the one that's been feeding you, bless your bishop. And I got tickled because I just talked to the Lord a little bit ago, before that call came, and I was telling the Lord about something, and the Lord said, I got you. You know, I love it when he just whispers to me, say, I got you. And then did not my phone respond? And I looked at it and said, Bishop, what's your Cash App? I said, God, you are amazing. I mean, I'm just amazed at our God, you know, how he has fun with us and trusting him. Have fun with your faith. Have fun trusting your God. When an opportunity comes up, don't get down. Don't crash. Don't cave in. Look up and say, okay, God, this is another opportunity. Show out on my behalf. Show out for your glory and watch him do that. So the Bible says she and her house did eat many days. Look at that. May I ask you, what's your mindset about your house right now? What is your mindset about what's in your cupboards? What's your mindset about what's in your bank account right now? What's your mindset about what's in the refrigerator? Because you don't see it today doesn't mean it's not coming. Because it's not in the bank today doesn't mean it's not on the way. Elijah said if she would bake that bread for the prophet, God would take care of her by causing the flour and the oil not to be used up until the day that the Lord gives rain on the land. Well, all she needed the miracle for was during the famine, because once it started raining, she could go back to gardening again. Once it started raining, she could go back to raising livestock again. Amazing thing about this widow's faith is that she simply obeyed the man of God that represented the word of God. You don't see where she argued with the man of God. The widow obeyed. The miracle happened. The flour and oil did not run out, and Elijah had a place to stay in the widow's home. Truth number two, when the cherub dries up, God prepares a Zarephath for you. Can you see it? The widow and her son, food to eat. They did not die of starvation. Elijah had a room and a bed. The prophet had someone to talk to. He even had a little boy to tease. Let me warn you, right at your miracle, you can just about know that the enemy will try to come in some kind of way to steal your joy and to steal your peace. But you know what? Nothing happens outside of the counsel of his will. First of all, before anything comes at you, it's already gone through the hands of God and it's already been sifted before it even hits you, before it's even thrown at you. After some time, I can hear the prophet say to the widow, you know, the best thing that ever happened to me was for my brook to dry up. Man, all this good eating and I got up in here, pancakes and biscuits and dumplings and all that stuff, and got a little boy to tease. I'm normally by myself as a prophet, as a man of God, but you know, I got a bed to sleep in. Man, that's the best thing. And right at that time, when he's celebrating and she's celebrating, the brook dries up and something happens. After that brook dries up, he's at her house. And you know what? Just like he did it for the prophet and the widow, God will do it for you. Let me say this before we go to our last point. God is bigger than a dry brook. God's bigger than the lost job. He's bigger than that deep disappointment. He's bigger than the wounded spirit. He's bigger than that current problem. God is bigger than that giant that's in your face. You know what? God knows about the place called Zarephath. Zarephath represents the place God will sustain you. It represents the place of refining. It represents the place where you learn to replace fear with faith. If you follow him, he'll get you there. Let's go to scene three. That's the point I want to make. In the midst of these miracles, the widow's son took sick and he died. Yeah, he died. Right in the middle of celebrating the miracle, he died. Joy. went right out the window at the house. Here is the widow, beside herself with grief. She's overwhelmed like families are being overwhelmed, even in this hour. She blames the prophet. She blames God. She said, this is too much. Truth three, great blessings are usually followed by great testings. This was not just a tragic drama for the widow. It has happened repeatedly to me, and I'm sure to many of you. About everyone I know will walk through something like this. After a wonderful answer to prayer comes a serious testing. So what do we do when the fantastic runs out? What do we do when the dark clouds just roll in on us? When the heaviness settles down on our soul, when your pride and joy dies, do we quit? Do we throw in the towel? Do we murmur? Do we run? Do we lose hope? Do we get bitter? Do we curse God and die? No, there's another scene in this drama. Scene number four, Elijah took the little boy up to his room, laid him on his bed, prayed earnestly to the Lord, God three times. Then he cried, oh Lord, my God, let this boy's life return to him. God heard, answered his prayer. Breath was given back to the little lad. It was a miracle of resurrection. I come to tell you, with the Elijah Church, God will give many miracles of resurrections. What you think you've lost, what you think has died, when God breathes on it, it will be resurrected. Notice Elijah went right to God and cried out. If you're in the desert right now, if something looked like it has died on you, you cry out to God like Elijah did. The grieving widow and her living son were united. There was rejoicing, there was celebration. A miracle had happened. What a turn of events. So here's the truth, number four. This is what I want you to do while you're listening to me. Get a piece of paper or get something and write this. God is greater than. I want you to fill in that blank. God is greater than. God was greater than the wicked King Ahab. God is greater than any president of any country. God is greater than Washington, D.C. and all of the politicians up on the hill. God is greater than the brook, greater than what's in your bank account, greater than the job you work on or used to work on, greater than the dead boy. God is greater than anything on this earth. And I tell you, he's greater than anything you can or cannot see. And that's the truth the world needs to hear right now, that God is greater. That's the truth that the church needs to be reminded of right now, that God is greater. And that is the truth I need to hear and remind myself. That is the truth every pastor right now needs to hear. I don't know what's happening in the circle of your life, but I know God is greater. So go ahead, write it out, put it on the wall, put it on your computer screen, anywhere you can remind yourself of the power of a great God. Again, write this down. God is greater than, and you fill in the blank. Whatever it is, whoever it does not matter. God is greater. So in my closing today, I dare you to believe and trust God in this hour. As you fill in that blank, join me as I've done the same, to know God is greater. The Lord will be at the next place to provide, whether that's tomorrow, next month, the month after that. Don't you start doubting now. God's got a track record, and he did not bring us this far to leave us. God will speak to you at the next place, just as he used you in the previous place. Again, and the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail. And according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah. Friend, you may not have everything you want, but you'll have everything you need. Your ability to trust God will result in others being saved. Just know, somebody's watching you at Zarephath. Somebody's watching how you handle the situations and circumstance. They are looking at your faith, and they're seeing you exchange your fear for faith. Somebody's watching you in this desert school of learning. The widow of Zarephath was apparently saved as a result of caring for the man of God. There are certain blessings. My dad would say, when you bless God for his word and you bless the messenger and the one that brings the word to you, there are blessings that God will bestow upon you. This is the season for the Elijah Church. Believe the word of the Lord, so shall you be established. Believe his prophet, so shall you prosper. God bless you. God keep you. Let me pray with you. If you're one of those and you have never really accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, Will you do it right now? Maybe you're saying, you know what, Bishop Vaughn, that's it right there. My brook has dried up. Maybe all of these things are happening to me right now because the Lord is trying to get my attention to move to the next place so he can reveal himself and I can have communion with him and so I can be restored to him so he can cut away the flesh and so he can begin to refine me. And I'm willing to say yes to him to say, dear Lord, take me to the next place. Will you pray this prayer with me? If you're a backslider, make the U-turn. Come home. We're waiting for you. God is waiting for you. Pray this prayer with us. Dear Lord, I acknowledge that I'm a sinner. I believe Jesus died for my sins on the cross and rose again the third day. I repent of my sins. By faith, I receive the Lord Jesus as my Savior. Pray with me. You promised to save me, and I believe you because you are God and cannot lie. I believe right now that the Lord Jesus is my personal Savior and that all my sins are forgiven through his precious blood. I thank you, dear Lord, for saving me in Jesus' name, amen. And I want you to know the family of God welcomes you. Look to that screen, click on that button down there at the bottom right, and let us know that you gave your life to the Lord today so we can celebrate with you. If you prayed that prayer, God heard you, you're saved, I personally want to welcome you to God's family. Tell us about your salvation, leave a little testimony, and tell us how the word has helped you and how it has been enlightening to you even as a believer. Let's get ready, plant that seed. We're in an Elijah church season right now. Call your harvest in and watch and see what God does when little becomes much, when you place it in his hands. And you shall lack nothing. You shall lack nothing because he has you.
Thank you for joining us for Church Online. We hope you enjoyed this worship experience. Don't forget, stay connected by joining our Facebook group or follow us on Instagram. Did you accept Christ into your life today? You may be wondering, so what's next? We encourage you to text the word ecard to the number 913-732-1055 and fill out that digital connection card. We want to give you some resources to help you learn more about God and get connected with other Christ followers. At EC, we believe that all people matter to God, and we're passionate about helping people know God, find freedom, discover their purpose, and empower them to make a difference right where they are. We hope you choose to partner with us to reach the world on behalf of Christ and to continue to join us for one of our weekly services. We hope to see you soon.